In this video, we'll show you how to perform left bundle branch area pacing in a patient requiring His bundle ablation. A popular approach is with the C315 His guiding catheter, which is a non-deflectable guiding catheter with 7 French exterior diameter and is 43 centimeters in length. It is used to deliver the 3830 Select Secure pacing lead, also from Medtronic. It is very popular since the lead has no lumen and is therefore very thin, which allows for easy penetration of the interventricular septum. However, stylet-driven leads may also be used to perform left bundle branch area pacing. We have used an axillary venous approach, of which we have another video. Now the guiding catheter can be introduced into the heart, together with the dilator and the guide wire. In some cases, the guide wire can be kept in place to gain access to the RV in case when it was difficult to pass the tricuspid valve. But in most cases, this is not necessary. The dilator and guide wire can now be removed to allow insertion of the pacing lead. Note that this lead has an extended and fixed helix. It's very thin when compared to conventional pacing leads. The lead can now be introduced while making sure that the distal end does not exit the guiding catheter. Unipolar pacing helps in finding the area of interest, showing a W pattern in lead V1. On the fluoroscopy, we can see that the lead tip is against the high basal septum. Turning the fluoroscopy to RAO view reveals that the lead tip is pointing towards 2 o'clock. Now towards LAO view to make sure that the guiding catheter is placed perpendicular on the septum. Under a slight LAO view, the lead is advanced into the septum using a few quick turns. Note how on fluoroscopy the lead moves through the interventricular septum towards the LV endocardium. The lead is reconnected to the programmer, always in unipolar setup. The lead adequately senses the irregular ventricular rhythm. An injury current on the distal tip should be present, together with R waves. The impedance should be relatively high, associated with septal myocardium. Diminishing pacing outputs may expose changes in CRS morphology, revealing selective versus non-selective capture. In this case, no CRS changes are observed, which could help to distinguish between selective and non-selective LVP capture. The time from pacing artifact to peak in V6 or LVAD is 70 milliseconds in this case, suggesting LVP capture. Should be within 75 milliseconds in narrow QRS patients and within 80 milliseconds in patients with native wide QRS complexes. Another criterion of LVP capture is the R wave prime, lead V1. In this second case, with conduction disease after a TAVI procedure, some other features will be shown. Since the patient has LVP and the guiding catheter can bump into the RV and create a V-block, the atrial lead is temporarily placed in the RV to enable RV backup pacing. The guiding catheter is again placed high on the septum, but now closely watch the ECG. As we can clearly see premature ventricular beats with delayed RV activation, a good sign of imminent LVP capture. Also note on fluoroscopy how both the tip and the ring are out of the guiding catheter, signifying a deep septal position. When equipped with an electrophysiology system, setting up a trigger to more easily measure the LVAT may facilitate the procedure. Note how the peak of the R-wave in V6 occurs before the red line, indicating a short LVAT. The R-prime wave in lead V1 occurs much later than the peak in V6, which is also a sign of LVP capture. A cutoff of 44 milliseconds is most often used. High output pacing may further shorten the LVAT, indicating that more LVP fibers may be recruited with a few additional turns of the lead. Look closely to lead V6 on the left screen as we apply 10 volts. We see a slight jump of the R wave, shortening of the LVAT, which may motivate us to add another turn in order to improve the result. Now, back to the first case, where we will remove the guiding catheter using a slitting tool under fluoroscopic guidance. Lead displacement is rare, as the helix is screwed deep within the septum. After removing the guiding catheter, the lead needs again to be tested. While we see a monophasic and short R wave in V6 and R prime wave in lead V1, the result is less striking than in the second case. There is ongoing discussion whether dependent patients need a backup RV pacing lead, since LBBAP can be considered experimental. In this case, it was decided to place a standard RV pacing lead as backup in case of 3830 lead failure. Fluoroscopy shows that the standard RV pacing lead is clearly thicker than the 3830 and is placed more apical. The ECG shows how much wider the QRS complexes are when compared to LBBAP. In general, a LBBAP lead does not require special programming of the pacemaker. The RV backup lead may be connected to the atrial channel, so the device can be switched to VVI after a few months. But guidelines recommend connecting it to the RV channel, so that oversensing of the LBBAP lead does not inhibit pacing.